Hachette Audio presents Places in the Darkness, written by Chris Brookmyre, read by Robin Miles. For Kiva. Prologue. Some assembly required.
Consciousness does not exist, says Mehmet.
Jenna has just caught up to her lab partner as they glide along the main level 2 conduit inside the axle, his eyes betraying that his focus is not entirely fixed on his immediate environment. He is reading something on his lens. That sounds deep for this time of day, Jenna replies, by way of bidding him good morning.
No, it's the name of the lecture Maria Gonsalves is giving today. Really wish I could have seen that.
You'll see it after you finish work. And you've seen 100. What's so special about this one?
I mean, seen it live. She's giving it in person.
Okay, now she gets it.
Seriously? Wow. When did that last happen? When I was in diapers, probably.
Damn. Couldn't you have swapped your shift? Mehmet fixes her with a withering look.
Yeah, like that's why I won't be there.
Only the great and the good able to get tickets, Jenna suggests.
Tickets? You jest. Invite only. But on the plus side, they sent me my date for getting the new Gen 4 mesh. 4 weeks today.
Way to go. I'm not even on the formal waiting list. I'm on the waiting list for the waiting list.
How come?
My own stupid fault. Dragged my heels because I wasn't convinced it would make much of a difference.
But that's not what I'm hearing from the people who have got it. No kidding, Mehmet says, warming to the subject. I was talking to Javier last week. He's had his a month. He says the data retrieval is night and day's difference. It's like you just instantly know the information.
Yeah. I hear there's far less of a watermarking effect. You don't get that feeling like you're peering over somebody's shoulder at their worksheet. Guess I'm gonna have to wait a while to experience it, though. They reach a 6-way junction, both of them changing axis with a practiced light tug on a handhold. Official protocol states that personnel are supposed to come to a complete stop before proceeding. But right now, there's nobody else around to bump into. That's what she loves about working in the axle. There never is. Compared to the wheels, it's always practically deserted.
Lateness appears to be a consistent theme for you at the moment, Mehmet says. I thought I was going to end up on my own here today.
Sorry. There was a problem on the static. They had a car at a commission, meaning a knock-on delay, and then the car I got from Ferris was rammed.
Little flavor of home. When the static is busy like that, close your eyes, and you could be on the subway train in New York City. Just need somebody to piss on the floor a few hours before. Give it that authentic smell to recreate the full effect.
Jenna yawns and stretches as they drift along the shaft.
Late night? Mehmet inquires.
No, just feels like it's been a long week. Late night tonight, though. Gonna tear it up.
Got a date?
Only with one of those famous Sin Garden mojitos over on Lane. Then, maybe 5 more.
Mehmet shakes his head, a wry smile on his face.
What? You still think I'm crazy paying those prices? She asks.
No. I think it's funny that somebody is getting a backhander purely for growing mint to supply those things.
Unauthorized botanical cultivation. Can't imagine that's what the Seguridad call a jump seat offense.
No, but I'm sure some prick at the FNG would be able to tell you the exact expected yield in zucchini or whatever that they would otherwise be growing in that square footage of soil.
And what about your social life? She asks. I hear you're switching phase on us.
Mehmet looks bashful. Yeah, this guy I've been seeing, it's getting serious.
He's on Meridian. And you're leaving all us sweet people on Atlantic for him? It really must be love.
I already got a lot of friends who are on Meridian phase. Been thinking of making a change for a while. This was just the final nudge, you scope me?
Jenna fixes him with a look. He withers.
Okay. It is love,
he admits. Knew it.
So what tests we running today?
He asks, conspicuously changing the subject. Jenna smiles by way of acknowledgement. It'll be a shame when he switches. She likes working with him. The test chamber is now only a few meters ahead. The entrance is a bladed aperture at the end of the shaft, but inside, it's like a giant buckyball. She and Mehmet are both in synthetic pharmacology research based out of Wheel 2. The firm they work for has a block booking on this chamber, studying the sustained effects of microgravity on certain artificial compounds. That's weird, she says, reading the security status on her lens. The chamber is open.
It looks unambiguously closed to me, Mehmet responds, confused.
I mean it's not locked. The team using it last can't have closed up properly.
See? These are the losers and wasters you're about to throw your lot in with when you shift to Meridian.
Without the security interface requesting an access code, they don't have to stop outside. The aperture dilates in response to their proximity, so they can let their momentum carry them inside uninterrupted. Jenna executes a somersault to emphasize this fact, but as she spins upright again, she is tugged to a stop. Mehmet has grabbed the rim for purchase with one hand and taken hold of her shoulder with the other. She looks at him by way of demanding an explanation. Mehmet is staring into the vastness of the chamber, eyes wide, speechless, shivering, scared. In zero G, the gentle ballet of objects in motion can make anything look elegant. Not this. Glistening organs dance gently around each other in the bright expanse, like motes of dust in a shaft of sunlight. Intestines curl and twist between sections of limbs denuded of skin, muscle exposed, like illustrations in an anatomy textbook. She sees an empty skull, the top sheared off. The brain has been removed, floating free amidst this carnal constellation. Jenna is almost as much a geek as Mehmet for the work of the Neurosophy Foundation. But the one thing she never got is why they are pioneering memory erasure. She couldn't understand why anyone would want that. She does now.
Part 1. Awakening. 1. There will be no children. It is the first thought that flashes into Alice's mind as she slowly approaches consciousness, like a diver rising towards the surface. The words are prompted by a sound, that of children's voices, laughing and shrieking with delight. At first, she thinks she is imagining them, but though her eyes are closed, she knows the voices are coming from outside her head. There will be no children. It is one of the things she remembers being told to expect about her first trip to Ciudad de Cielo, CDC. And yet, she can hear them clear as day. Is it a recording? She opens her eyes. She can only see directly in front the beige wall of the passenger capsule's interior. Her head is restrained for safety inside a protective cradle, but the brace is not there purely to hold her in position. It also houses sensors monitoring her vital signs, which it streams to her lens, superimposing the data upon her field of vision. The standard lens system comprises one contact for each eye, transferring data to and from a circular processing unit attached to the wrist. This disc also accommodates a sensor that interprets finger gestures by way of a primary control interface. The rig is completed by a subvocal audio relay that integrates so seamlessly with one's hearing that Alice sometimes forgets it's an auxiliary source. It is from this that the children's laughter briefly issues once more.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.